Welcome to the LaRouche Connection. My name is Webster Tarpley. Today, our topic is the case of the so-called Unabomber. As is widely known, the FBI has recently arrested a suspect, a certain Theodore Thomas Kaczynski. Mr. Kaczynski resided in a cabin without electricity or running water that was located near Lincoln, Montana. It appears that the FBI is preparing to accuse Kaczynski of at least some of the crimes attributed to the Unabomber, which is the label that the FBI has chosen to give to the person or persons responsible for a series of bombs and letter bombs, which over the past 18 years have killed 3 and injured 20 others. We must caution at the outset that while the FBI claims to have found some circumstantial evidence in Mr. Kaczynski's cabin, including a bomb or bomb components, these materials do not yet link Kaczynski with any of the bombing attacks that have made the so-called Unabomber infamous. Nevertheless, as soon as Kaczynski was arrested, the various scribblers of the media began to psychoanalyze him. Kaczynski was a hermit kind of guy, we were told, a pathologically reclusive man, an intensely private man, a bearded eccentric who had lived a Thoreau-like existence in a crude shack for the past quarter century. Kaczynski was a mathematician, a nerdy introvert, we were told, who had studied Kant before graduating from Harvard, where he obtained a PhD, then from the University of Michigan, and worked as an assistant professor at Berkeley, before finally dropping out, as it would appear, in 1969. And why did this recluse begin making bombs? Family pathology, say the adherents of this theory. Either his mother did not hug him enough, or he was jilted by his girlfriend back in Evergreen Park, Illinois, say these commentators. A prominent purveyor of these theories has been Clint Van Zandt, a former member of the FBI's deplorable behavioral science unit at Quantico, Virginia. As we have often stressed on this program, the myth of the isolated and disgruntled individual who is pushed by oppression or psychosis into a career as a terrorist is just that, a myth. Such cases are almost never found in reality. The quasi-psychotic individual may indeed be the raw material for the later terrorist, but the process will never be completed without the intervention of an outside force, usually an intelligence agency. The intelligence agency has the resources to provide the terrorist with money, favors, protection, publicity. The intelligence agency can also provide social support for the terrorist in the form of a movement of sympathizers who provide ideology, applause, encouragement, safe houses, logistics, and the like. One good method for discovering which political forces are backing the terrorist is to compare their propaganda. If the leaders of a political faction and a terrorist group use the same arguments or language or agree on a course of action, then there is reason to suspect that they may be connected. If we now examine the so-called Unabomber's ideological manifesto, published in the Washington Post in 1995, we find that the main thrust of the argument is an attack on industrial society and its scientific and technological underpinning. For the intelligence professional today, this is the familiar ID format of British intelligence in the City of London, the intelligence agencies most active against the United States today. The Unabomber's victims include science and engineering professors, airline officials, and more recently, business people connected to the timber industry and to the Exxon Valdez oil spill of 1989. There are indications that amidst Kaczynski's reading material, there may have been found copies of Live Wild or Die, a publication close to Earth First, which has published an eco-bleeper hit list targeting the Timber Association of California, among others. In April 1995, the Unabomber killed by letter bomb a timber industry lobbyist, Gilbert Murray. In December of 1994, the Unabomber used a letter bomb to kill Thomas Mosser. The Unabomber later said that he had targeted Mosser because he was an executive of Burston Marsteller, a public relations firm which allegedly had helped Exxon clean up its public image after the Exxon Valdez incident. Burston Marsteller had, in its own turn, been targeted for exactly the same reason by Earth First in the February-March 1994 issue of its magazine. Earth First and its satellite, Live Wild or Die, are, of course, leading organizations of the radical ecology movement. We will hear much more about Earth First, which gained notoriety in the Pacific Northwest by placing steel spikes in trees so that they would maim or kill loggers trying to cut down these trees. Earth First was stridently pro-terror and pro-violence until 1990, when its founder, David Foreman, was arrested for trying to blow up a nuclear plant in Arizona. Since then, the facade of Earth First has become more respectable, while its satellite organizations incite to violence. It is clear that the Unabomber's targets and the targets of Earth First were the same. As for Kaczynski, whatever his eccentricity, he was not always a hermit. He is reported to have been a loudmouth and an ideologue who liked to attend pro-wilderness and other ultra-green radical gatherings. One of these took place in November 1994 in Missoula, Montana. It was sponsored by the Native Forest Network. Author Barry Clausen says that Kaczynski's name was on the sign-in sheet of this meeting. The Missoula meeting was attended by eco-terrorists and animal rights extremists from the World Wildlife Fund, the National Audubon Society, to Greenpeace, Earth First, and the Animal Liberation Front. Also on hand was a speaker of the Zapata Liberation Army, the terrorist insurgents from Chiapas province in southern Mexico. The Native Forest Network was founded in Australia in 1990 under the aegis of the Rainforest Action Network and the Australian Conservation Foundation. The latter group was founded and chaired by Prince Philip of Britain. Now, more evidence could be added, but the main point is clear. Kaczynski moved in the circles of the British-founded and British-backed eco-terrorism movement. The Unabomber's stated program is the equivalent of Prince Philip's, when Philip said that he wanted to be reincarnated as a deadly virus in order to kill people and thus fight overpopulation. Finally, if Kaczynski has indeed participated in the crimes of the Unabomber, important questions are posed. If these bombs required machine tools and electricity, and the shack had no current, who provided this key logistical backup? Where did Kaczynski get money to survive, as well as to travel around the country to place some of his bombs? Where did he stay overnight when he went on these travels? If he went to Afghanistan, as it appears he did, how did he pay for that? These questions suggest that the Unabomber is a network rather than a single person, and that this network will be found to be embedded in and directed by the same social milieu founded by Prince Philip and the Nazi Prince Bernard of Holland back in 1961 when they created the World Wildlife Fund and its later ramifications. With us in the studio today are Jeff Steinberg, the counterintelligence editor of Executive Intelligence Review and one of our regular guests. Also with us today is Roger Maduro, the author of a very influential refutation of the ozone hoax. I'd like to welcome both of you to the LaRouche connection. And I guess the way to get at the issues posed by the so-called Unabomber story is to take it in the way that the normal news media never do, which is to study the network first and then bring it down to this individual case. So maybe we ought to start by this question. I've tried to pose it at the beginning. From Prince Philip to terrorist bombs in the United States, what's the connection?
Well, there is a we have documented extensively in the Executive Intelligence Review that there has been a whole progression of how these radical groups have been founded. From the time of the founding of the World Wildlife Fund, what you've had is a whole succession of groups being created, each one more extreme than the previous one. For example, you got World Wildlife Fund is founded in 61. And then in 68, 69, you have the creation of Greenpeace in Vancouver, Canada, as an anti-nuclear group. And Greenpeace was created as by British intelligence. The top people that created it were engaged, were all either directly members of British intelligence or been associated with it. And their first target was the United States and then France. And then after Greenpeace is created, you have another wave of groups. This whole wave of groups are created in the period 68 to 72, when the environmental movement was created almost out of thin air. And then you had a second wave of groups that were created in the period of 1978 to 1980, when you had The Sea Shepherd was created to conduct acts of terrorism in the high seas. Earth First was created with funding from the Sierra Club and the National Wilderness Society. The founder of Earth First is David Foreman, who's now a member of the board of the Sierra Club, and we'll see this a little bit later. And they were even more violent than the previous wave of groups that were created. So each successive wave becomes more violent. More recently, Earth First spun off a group called the Earth Liberation Front to carry out direct acts of terrorism because they wanted to separate themselves a little bit from the what they call direct action. And the first clue as to how the network works is ideological. If you look at the founding principles of the World Wildlife Fund, they're identical to the founding principles of Earth First. And I want to point this out to you, and there's a set of quotes here I want to read to people to get an idea how closely, philosophically, Prince Philip of Mountbatten, the consort to the British Queen, is to David Foreman, the radical founder of Earth First.
He went around putting spikes in the trees and tried to blow up the nuclear plant.
And he's written, David Foreman has written a book, an entire book on how to conduct acts of eco-terrorism. They call it monkey wrenching. You know, how to blow up bulldozers and make bombs. And it's all in the book. It just describes to you how to carry out all these acts of irregular warfare. And they've done a tremendous amount of destruction that does not get reported in the news media. Private investigator Barry Clausen, who infiltrated Earth First for about a year and a half to 2 years in the early 1990s, actually got to meet the whole leadership of Earth First. He saw them committing acts of terrorism. He tried to report it to the authorities, who didn't listen to him. But recently he has put together a whole grid of acts of eco-terrorism in the United States, and you have more than 200 acts of terrorism in just the last 4 years. And we're not talking here about tree spiking. We're talking about burning logging mills, for example, is blowing up logging mills. I mean, this is serious stuff. Now, on the question of Prince Philip, in 1988, Prince Philip was interviewed by a German press agency, and he stated, "In the event that I am reincarnated, I would like to return as a deadly virus in order to contribute something to solve overpopulation." A few months earlier, David Foreman, the founder of Earth First, wrote an article in the issue of Earth First Journal, November 8th issue, 87 issue of the Earth First Journal. AIDS is not a malediction, but the welcome and natural remedy to reduce the population of the planet. Should human beings disappear, I surely wouldn't mind. Just as the Black Plague ended the feudal era, so AIDS will end the industrial era of progress. This is a good thing, since industrial progress brings population growth.
And if I'm not mistaken, in the most recent generation or degeneration of this whole phenomenon, you've got an animal rights activist movement who actually say that their program is to kill people in order to save animals and the environment, which I guess gets us right back to Prince Philip.
Yeah, this is the very openly stated purpose of the animal rights movement. It's very openly stated in all the circles. They couch it in different ways. Prince Philip is very nice about it. He said the world's population has to be reduced to less than a billion people. And most people don't even think in terms of what does that mean. How do you reduce the world's population to less than a billion people? Well, you can't
just 4 billion plus.
You got to kill a lot of people.
Maybe I can ask Jeff now. We have to realize that many of our viewers have an epistemological difficulty at this point, which is how, again, can you get Prince Philip and these radical terrorists in the same boat? Maybe you could approach the connections from the top.
I think there's a very important thing to bear in mind. Prince Philip and Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands, who you mentioned in your introduction, and he was literally a card-carrying member of the Nazi Party during the Second World War. In 1961, Prince Philip, Prince Bernhard, and a group of very wealthy, very prominent people, principally from Britain, the Netherlands, and a few other European countries, who were among them leading bankers, members of royal families, top corporate executives, launched the modern phase of the radical environmentalist movement. Radical in the sense that the ideas were a radical rejection of modern civilization, modern technology, the idea of scientific and technological progress and population growth. As part of that effort, they tried to basically reintroduce pre-Christian pagan cultism and literally irrationalist practices into modern society. And the particular form that this took was the launching of the drug, rock, sex counterculture during the 1960s. Here in the United States, this was a decade of tremendous traumatic developments. The assassination of Kennedy, the assassination of Martin Luther King, the riots, the war in Vietnam, the assassination of Robert Kennedy. People who came into the 1960s optimistic about the future, committed to careers in science or in industry or in education, had their minds scrambled. They became very confused, demoralized. They became susceptible to a top-down drug culture that was also being fostered by people like Aldous Huxley, Lord Bertrand Russell, again, prominent people from this international, aristocratic, what you would call the oligarchy. Now, it's not surprising that it's in the late 1960s that groups like these radical environmentalist groups begin to proliferate. Greenpeace, Friends of the Earth, these organizations begin to take on the character of mass social movements because for the first time in the modern period, in the post-war period, you've got a large bunch of people who've been driven stark raving mad through a combination of drugs, philosophical ideas that rejected science and technology and progress, the whole drug, rock, sex counterculture. So, in effect, what was created was a kind of labor pool of people who simply adopted ideas that were the prevailing views of this top-down, British-centered financial oligarchy. Ideas expressed by Prince Philip in saying that world population growth is the greatest threat to mankind. We've got to kill millions or hundreds of millions of people. Now, in the late 1960s, Prince Philip and Prince Bernhard set up a very ambitious funding mechanism because now suddenly they had a very large international mass movement to bankroll. And they created an organization called the 1001 Club because 1001 very wealthy people were invited to become charter members. These were people on the personal phone directories of Prince Philip and Prince Bernhard. And the requirement for membership in the 1001 Club was, first of all, to be invited and to be in the social ambiance of these top people. And number two, you had to be willing to write out an initial check for at least $10,000 to create this seed fund of $10 million that went towards bankrolling the Friends of the Earth, Greenpeace, and then, as Roger just indicated, Next Generation, an even more crazy, radical, wild group of people has spawned off of that to carry out even more violence. And what we've documented in the EIR, particularly in a series of special reports in the last two or three years, is that there is a remarkably small circle of people who include top executives. For example, the heir of the imperial chemical industry of Britain has gone from being a top official of the World Wildlife Fund to being a leading figure within Greenpeace. And so they commingle very easily and very comfortably with these sort of dregs or victims of the counterculture who've been basically picked up off the streets and are the kind of brainwashed victims of the ideologies that are produced at this high level. So it's actually a very rich contoured picture, and the degree of collaboration and the tightness of the control exerted amazingly by people like Prince Philip is very intense. This Native Forest Network, for example, which had the conference at the University of Montana in Missoula, which was attended by Kaczynski. This organization was founded a few years earlier in Australia by an organization that was at the time chaired by Prince Philip. So it's not some enormous magical leap from Windsor Castle down to this rather impoverished cabin in Montana where Kaczynski was hiding out.
Well, we've heard about the World Wildlife Fund or whatever it calls itself today. We've got the Friends of the Earth and so forth. Why don't we focus a little bit on the more recent, more violent groups and get an idea of this social milieu? Now, we've mentioned some things about Earth First. As I understand it, they have a kind of a two-track theory where you want to have a public legal organization that spews out propaganda, and then with some plausible deniability, you've got a kind of an underground wing that actually does the killing. And they seem to be telling everybody this is the way to go. So this gives us Earth First, and I guess this other thing, Live Wild or Die. What do we need to know about them?
Well, fundamentally, these really are pagan cults. What they believe in is in the same kind of philosophy that the Druids used to believe in. And their newspaper.
Cult.
Yeah, they
remember the Druid horoscope is that the day you're born, you're assigned a tree.
Right.
And as I remember, the oak tree got one day a year, and that's what they all wanted because that was the best tree.
The tree huggers.
Prince Charles, of course, says he talks to plants. Prince Philip is somebody who has made raving speeches about Gaia, the mother of the gods. I guess that's close enough.
Well, they worship the earth. They worship Gaia. It's this pagan gods. And in terms of Earth First itself, if you look at their journal, the Earth First Journal is published on 8 pagan holidays. And that's when they hold their actions and their rendezvous and their big events are all centered around pagan holidays. And they worship paganism. So what you're looking at is not just a question of a bunch of people who want to protect the earth, which is not really what they're interested in. They're interested in worshiping the earth. And in scientific terms, they believe in what's called deep ecology. That's how it gets, or the biodiversity. Conservation biology is what it's called, in order to try to pass it off as a respectable theory, which it is not. It lacks any scientific evidence. But you have this whole underground, and in the Unabomber writings, he refers to it very explicitly in the letters that he sent to the New York Times, in the manifesto that he wrote. You pick up the manifesto and you pick up the Earth First Journal, and they're almost completely indistinguishable. Likewise for these animal rights publications, like a declaration of war, the title is A Declaration of War, Killing Humans to Save the Animals. You pick that up and you put it side by side with the manifesto, and they're almost identical. And it is astonishing that the FBI missed this.
Okay, we're going to get to the FBI in just a minute. The Earth First, as I recall, in places like Washington State, Oregon, became an intense public issue. They'd put up signs in the community, if you're from Earth First, don't stop here, keep going. Right? They became hated by the people in these towns who they saw Earth First as a group that was out to destroy their livelihoods, right?
It's not just their families. The Pacific Northwest. It's in California. It's in the Southwest, Arizona, New Mexico. They're very active in Vermont and Maine. They're very active in Canada, stirring up all kinds of troubles. They've been demonstrating against nuclear power plants. Likewise in Michigan, they're into what you call direct action. Is what they call direct action, which is doing things to stop production, doing things to shut down the nuclear power plants. As a matter of fact, at one point, a group of Earth Firsters, led by David Foreman, the founder, tried to blow up a nuclear power plant in Arizona. And he actually almost ended up in jail because of that. So they're very dedicated. And the debate that they've been having for the last 5 years is, well, do we carry out these acts of what they call monkey wrenching, which by actual official definition, both the Justice Departments and Interpol, these are acts of terrorism. Do we carry out monkey wrenching in our name, or do we set up an outfit, which they call the Earth Liberation Front, to carry out the acts of terrorism? And then what we will do is have the same kind of relationship that the People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals has with the Animal Liberation Front has. You have PETA as the upfront group. They carry out radical
PETA
actions.
PETA meaning?
People for the Ethical Treatment of Animals is PETA.
Right.
So PETA is the one that does the public relations. And then the Animal Liberation Front carries out the acts of terrorism. They blow up laboratories, they liberate animals, most of which die after they're liberated, so on and so forth. And they wanted Earth First to have the same kind of structure, and it has more or less worked like that. But the interesting thing is when you look at how all these things tie together, it's very interesting. You have somebody like Phil Knight, for example, who's one of the leaders of Earth First. He's also one of the leaders of the Native Forest Network, and actually one of the organizers of the conference that Kaczynski attended in Montana. He also happens to be the head of the Predator Project, which is an animal rights group defending predators from being killed.
Bring back the wolves.
Bring back the wolves. If, you know, if they kill people, it's just too bad. You know, they have a right to be here. Mm-hmm. Likewise for the mountain lions in California. I mean, they're protecting predators. Mm-hmm. As an animal rights activity. He's also an Earth Firster. And then also, when Barry Clausen had infiltrated Earth First, he discovered that Phil Knight was also the actual head of the Western cell of the Animal Liberation Front, which is classified as a terrorist group by the FBI. So they're all completely intermeshed, and they're intermeshed very closely with Prince Philip. I'm going to just go back to the question of Prince Philip, how this actually works. Back in 1977-78, Prince Philip personally, through the World Wildlife Fund, requested that Greenpeace launch a massive international campaign to end commercial whaling. And the World Wildlife Fund provided Greenpeace with their first two ocean-going ships, precisely to carry out actions against whaling nations, Iceland, Russia, and Japan. And in 78, after a couple of years of semi-successful direct actions, they took an added step, which was that Prince Philip and Sir Peter Scott, who was then the executive director of the World Wildlife Fund, had a series of secret meetings at the headquarters of the World Wildlife Fund in London. And this has been aired in a documentary called The Rainbow Man by Icelandic filmmaker Magnus Gudmundsson. It's a really top-notch documentary. And what ended up happening is during the secret meetings, what they created with David McTaggart, the head of Greenpeace, Sir Peter Scott, and Prince Philip overseeing the whole operation, they created a slush fund of $5 million. And the money was given to a Colombian scientist called Francisco Palacios, who went around all these little nations, particularly in the Caribbean, Commonwealth nations, mm-hmm. and he bribed these government officials to get them to get their countries to join the International Whaling Commission, and then let Greenpeace representatives vote for them at the meetings. Mm-hmm. And wherever Francisco Palacios went, he went with a letter of introduction from Prince Philip, ordering that official of the British Commonwealth to collaborate with Greenpeace in this whole operation. And by 1982, the International Whaling Commission had gone from having 17 members to having 37 members, and they had the majority, and they declared a moratorium on
based
whaling.
Based on bribery.
Based on bribery, and they had no scientific evidence for it.
Yeah, you mentioned this animal rights movement, and again, for our viewers, some of them have seen these television things about Earth First, but the animal rights movement, I get the impression that this is more visible, better organized as something you might see, say, in London than in Chicago or Los Angeles or New York. Maybe you could just give us a sense of what it looks like. Suppose you go to a meeting of the animal rights movement. What do you find?
You'll probably find Brigitte Bardot.
Right.
Or a Jane Fonda.
Yeah,
lot of the really bizarre characters in Hollywood, in the European film and arts community, have bought on to this ideology. And I think it's very interesting to note that the founder of Animal Liberation, a guy named Peter Singer, wrote a book called Animal Liberation, which is sold by PETA and all of these organizations as the Bible of the movement. At the time he wrote it, he was a PhD student at Oxford University in philosophy, and he was doing his doctoral dissertation on the 18th century British philosopher Jeremy Bentham, who said that there is no difference between human beings and lower forms of animal life. We're all creatures out to find pleasure and avoid pain, and that's all there is to it. And the argument that was put forward by Peter Singer was that man is no better than lower forms of animal life. In fact, in certain respects, man is inferior, and therefore man has no right whatsoever to use animals for experimentation, for scientific discovery, for food, for clothing, or any of this. And just think for a minute, if a grown-up human being adopts this kind of ideology, then it really says anything goes, that there is nothing sacred about human life, and you can do anything you want to another human being in order to save some rodent or snail darter from going into extinction. And so you've got people who are literally wacko and who carry out very serious acts of violence, I think it's important that the Animal Liberation Front is thoroughly integrated. Very often, as Roger just indicated, you'll find the head of the Animal